Today we are going to have a long journey with three interesting panel discussions packed with the distinguished guests. But before that, let's start with a solid groundwork from keynote address on ASEAN moving forward. It is our pleasure indeed to have with us the Secretary General of ASEAN. Ladies and gentlemen, please extend your warm welcome to His Excellency Le Leung Wen.
Good morning, Madam Sirat Ratanabana, Director General at the Ministry of Commerce of Thailand, Mr. Kalin Sarasin, Deputy Secretary General of the Thai Chamber of Commerce and Chairman of the Organizing Committee, Mr. Phongsak Akakui, Chairman of the Board of Trade of Thailand, and Mr. Devin Phongvanit, Chairman of the Thailand Management Association. Distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen, let me begin by thanking the Thai Chamber of Commerce, the Ministry of Commerce of Thailand, the Board of Trade of Thailand, and Thailand Management Association for organizing and inviting me to this very important event. I consider this event as timely amid the current global economic uncertainties that continue to challenge our business environment. It is also appropriate that this business forum is organized to reinvigorate interest in our ASEAN economies. Today's event also reaffirms our growing confidence in ASEAN. It is comforting that we are now talking about how to best mobilize our collective effort to move together to address economic challenges, and I am pleased that we are meeting with the private sector and the market players who are making great contribution to advancing the process of ASEAN integration. Looking at the region, ASEAN indeed has come a long way. ASEAN's average economic growth rate of 5.9% over the past 15 years, the period 1998-2012, far exceeds that of the global economy, which is 3.6%, and the advanced economies, 1.9%, as well as other regional groups, such as Central Eastern Europe, 3.6% again, and the Middle East and North Africa, 4.6%, and Sub-Saharan Africa, 5.1%. and Western Hemisphere, 3.2%. As a result of robust growth, ASEAN GDP per capita in current prices tripled from $1,198 in 2000 to $3,759 in 2012. Social conditions have also improved over the years, with reduced rates of poverty and economic and social disparities in most countries of ASEAN. However, in the current global context of weak growth due to the impacts of crisis in major regions and economies, it is obvious that the region cannot afford to be complacent. Given that uncertainty is still very high, ASEAN should always be cognizant of the emerging risk and remain vigilant while continuing to implement appropriate policies and strategies. And one important strategy for ASEAN is to stay more competitive through regional economic integration. In fact, that is what the ASEAN Economic Community that ASEAN is trying to achieve by 2015 is all about. When the ASEAN leaders envisioned in 1997 to create a stable region with free flow of goods, services, investment, and free flow of capital, the road to regional economic integration had been initially paved. The same vision was further reaffirmed in 2003 when they agreed to establish the ASEAN Economic Community as an end goal of integration. And since then, the goal has been to achieve a stable and integrated ASEAN. I always see integration as a positive sum game. It will make our production and consumption efficient. It will also expand the economies of scale and accelerate investment in physical capital, technology, and people key elements that we need to sustain economic growth and productivity. Of course, I'm not saying that we have already reached that goal. The reality is that ASEAN is still far from that. Our markets for goods, services, and factors of production are still evolving and are yet to become fully integrated. But the prospects are encouraging. The ASEAN economic community, when realized, can offer tremendous economic opportunities. It will boost the region's productivity and growth, enhance financial stability, expand investment, and increase economic resilience. For example, we estimate that ASEAN economic community will increase economic welfare by 5.3% or $69 billion in 2015 from the baseline level of 2008. It will also generate other spillover effects, such as increased cross-border trade and capital flows, higher per capita GDP, and greater macroeconomic stability. It is estimated that the ASEAN 5 will increase by 17% to 26% on average in per capita GDP. Productivity in smaller ASEAN countries, such as the CLMV countries, will also improve significantly. In fact, when this market integration is further deepened to include our FTA partners via the various FTA agreements, the benefits would be even more substantial. And the key achievement to date concerning the process of achieving the ASEAN economic community. So far, progress toward the AEC has been encouraging. Since the 2003 AEC declaration, ASEAN has implemented around 74% of the measures under the AEC blueprint. While there is still a large pending agenda of policy issues to achieve the AEC goal, there is no doubt that the AEC has brought important gain to the region. And what has been achieved so far? ASEAN has been fully established free trade area since 2010, thus allowing for free flow of goods within the region. Tariff barriers have been reduced to zero for ASEAN 5 and Brunei. And by 2015, for the rest of the region, intra-ASEAN trade has increased from 20.8% in 1990 to 25.4% in 2011. Measured in terms of trade intensity, our trade integration also exceeds that of other regions like the EU and Mercosur. Within the larger East Asian group, meaning ASEAN plus China, Japan, and Korea, intra-regional trade rose from 43% in 1990 to 55% in 2011. Trade costs within the region have been reduced by an average of 18% over the last decade and by about 8% with the rest of the world. A comprehensive ASEAN Trade in Goods Agreement, or the ATIGA, has been put in place to facilitate free flow of goods in the region. By 2015, we expect the ASEAN single window to be operational and contribute to increased custom integration in the region. A full self-certification program is also expected to be fully enforced, thus getting away from complicated rules of origin that deter businesses from coming to ASEAN. Our services commitments have been broadened and deepened, thus facilitating market access and national treatment across services sectors. 8 packages of services commitment have been completed, with more progressive liberalization still expected by 2015. 7 professional groups are now in the process of implement mutual recognition arrangement to facilitate free flow of skilled labor. And following the signing of the ASEAN Agreement on Movement of Natural Persons last year, the schedules of commitments are now ready to be endorsed by the economic ministers when they meet next month in Hanoi. Our approach to services liberalization is currently being enhanced to ensure that the AEC becomes more relevant to changing market conditions. ASEAN investment regimes are kept more open under the ASEAN Comprehensive Investment Agreement. In 2011, the region generated $114 billion FDI flows from $22 billion 10 years ago. Intra-FDI flows also increased significantly from $2.5 billion 10 years ago to $26 billion in 2011. With ACIA, or otherwise the ASEAN Comprehensive Investment Agreement, the goal is to not only benefit ASEAN investors, but also ASEAN-based foreign investors. I'm pleased to inform you that ASEAN has also adopted an approach or modality to reduce or eliminate investment restrictions, attract more investment, and increase competition in the region. However, realizing that there are still many remaining hurdles to potential investors, ASEAN is committed to further improve the legal framework for property rights, increase the efficiency of the markets for labor, for factors, goods and services, and improve the quality and coverage of our infrastructure. We have increasingly liberalized capital flows to support trade integration. Here I am proud of our recent successes in the region, including the establishment of ASEAN exchanges that will promote ASEAN as an asset class, and the various initiatives under the ASEAN Capital Market Forum and ASEAN Bond Markets Initiative. There are now more commitments to enhance the efficiency of banking and insurance services. Deeper and more liquid capital markets are also being promoted through increased transparency and harmonization of market standards. Our local currency bond markets have been deepened and financial safety nets have been developed through the multilateral swap arrangements. To ensure that ASEAN build the right and competitive market conditions have been improved in product and regulatory standards, financing systems, logistics and transport facilitation, and business procedures. These result in the large productivity gains in production and investment. For example, the $420 billion ASEAN Infrastructure Fund is ready to start lending operational this year, particularly in water and power infrastructure projects. But as we always emphasize, the AEC is not only about building markets, it is also about creating opportunities for the people. And that's why within the AEC, promoting equitable development is key. Although the development gap in the region is still high, the AEC has helped bridge the gap. For example, to share these CLMV countries to total ASEAN GDP has increased from 6% in 1990 to nearly 12% in 2011. And finally, the AEC has also become an effective platform for productive engagement with other countries outside the region. One good example is the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, or RCEP, that our leaders launched last November. The RCEP, the biggest single market with the total population of 3.3 billion people, accounting for one-third of the world trade and one-third of the world GDP. If successfully negotiated, will further establish ASEAN centrality in emerging regional economic architecture. And the road to the AEC about the prospects and challenges we are facing. Despite its progress, the overall integration agenda remains very challenging for us. One question that is often asked is whether the AEC goals can be realistically achieved by 2015 and beyond. While less than 3 years to go, a number of measures are still pending, particularly measures in services, investment, standards, and connectivity. However, I'm confident that the benefit of practicality, we can achieve our goals by 2015. But that means also that we have to do more and much more. If we want to make the AEC work, it implies producing credible results and addressing the most immediate concerns by the markets. And how should we do it? How we are going to do it? The immediate challenge is to prioritize. We need to focus on priority areas for integration and advance those areas where significant progress can be achieved. As emphasized by our leaders last year, we have to redouble our efforts and ensure that AEC initiatives are indeed working. Achieving the right balance between what the markets need and what countries can offer should be the norm. The more the markets understand the AEC, the closer we reach our targets. As a market-driven process, it is crucial that the AEC measures are closely aligned with the markets. For example, in facilitating free flow of goods, reducing logistics barriers to trade can be a priority. In services, it can be the provision of efficient transport and financial services to support trade flows. In investment, one priority is to increase equity participation in local industries and reduce business costs. And in facilitating free flow of capital, harmonizing withholding taxes and capital market standards can be the goal. Another challenge is to overcome the implementation bottlenecks. Despite progress in a number of areas, many AEC measures are still pending by the end of 2012. The important priority is to develop national regulations that take into account the regional commitments, and countries should incorporate the regional initiative into the national development plans, strategies, and budgetary allocation to make commitment to integration strong. Capacity building should also be given particular emphasis to enable policy makers in those countries to follow up through their commitments. It is about time also that we address the supply side constraint of our integration. Here, institutions can play a big role. One such institution is the strengthening of the dispute and settlement system in the region. A compliant system where government and firms can adhere to their obligations under the AEC should also be developed. With strong institutions, the responsibility of implementing and enforcing community decisions will become clear, and thus preventing countries to circumvent their obligations and undermine integration initiative. Strong regulatory reforms are crucial to help address market failures and international spillovers with inevitable consequences for trade flows and investment. With so many initiatives to implement by 2015, it is imperative that a strong monitoring system mechanism be put in place both at the country and regional levels. In the absence of an effective and well-functioning mechanism to monitor the outcomes, identify issues, and address implementation gaps, the risk of the AEC falling short of achieving its target by 2015 are high. And I'm sure you don't want to see that. We cannot afford to see that. Thus, a strong regional monitoring body is needed to follow through on regional commitments. And this should be complemented by an effective in-country monitoring of AEC measures based on actual implementation of integration initiatives. Let me conclude by pointing out that integration cannot be achieved without the support of various stakeholders in the country and in the region. While the political commitment is crucial, equally important are the market players who are supposed to drive the entire integration agenda forward. In the spirit of this business forum, I'd like to highlight once again the critical role of the public-private partnership in the process of building the AEC. It is evident that the ASEAN needs a dynamic private sector to enable our countries and the region to permanently raise investment and productivity. As such, private sector engagement has been high on the list of priorities. Since 2003, our ministers and officials have been engaging with the business leaders to seek their views and assist the region in various areas of trade and financial integration process. ASEAN has also held regular dialogue with the ASEAN Business Council, ASEAN Chamber of Commerce and Industry, as well as private sector representatives from dialogue partners and industry associations. To sustain this momentum, ASEAN is in the process of exploring a feedback mechanism by which a private-public partnership can be enhanced, mainly to assess efficiency and impact of ASEAN policies. We recognize that our government cannot do it alone. We need the private sector to partner with us. Such a partnership, in my view, is more important now in view of fast-changing economic and financial landscape in the post-crisis world. For example, an area where public-private partnership can thrive is the area of net private financing. Given the huge amount of net capital flows that have gone to the region over the last few years, we should like the private sector to work with us to develop new financial instruments and products and identify key sectors for investment. At the same time, we value the private sector's responsible leadership to reduce the incentive for excessive risk-taking. As the recent crisis have taught us, the interplay between the markets and policies is more important now than ever to ensure that we all reap the benefits of economic and financial globalization. I believe this is the one objective that both the government and the private sector in the region can work together successfully. Recognizing that economic integration is a market-driven process, ASEAN has engaged, and will continue to do so, with the private sector. Private sector engagement is critical to building an inclusive economic community. Without the private sector support, economic integration in ASEAN will be difficult to achieve. Our integration is a coordinated integration that is outward looking, market driven, and people centered. And ASEAN would make sure that we move forward in a pragmatic and gradual fashion to keep our integration efforts on track. I thank you for your attention.